didn't get a copy of the outline, you can download those off of the internet on our website, psd.church. At the very top, there's a thing that says recordings. Go down, and you'll be able to find that and follow along with us. We're going to look at a lot of Bible verses today, so we're going to be moving pretty quickly through the outline. So if you have an outline, it will be helpful and beneficial to you, and will help you follow along. So you can always download that, or just go to the back and get one. There should be some back there as well. This week, we saw a tragedy in Texas where 19 kids and two teachers were murdered by someone who came into a school with a gun. As I was looking at the news page this morning, I saw that there was a shooting in Chattanooga. There was a fake shooting outside a ball game which caused total chaos. We know that there is still war going on between Russia and Ukraine. You don't have to go very far to understand that there are problems in our society. Inflation is on the rise. You go to the gas station, you see gas is at a terrible high cost. There is chaos all around us every single day. And the solution isn't for us to find a way to get rid of the chaos in the world and make peace happen throughout the entire world. That is something that we just can't do, right? That is God's part of the equation. That's what He needs to be working on. Let Him take care of that. But what we can do, and what we're trying to walk you through in this series of sermons, is how we can have inner peace in the outer chaos. And Brian does a good job in those articles that we have in the bulletin to use that concept throughout each one of these seven principles that we are discussing. So we are looking at how we as God's people can have this inner calm, this inner peace, even though everything in the world is so chaotic and there's chaos all around us. We started looking at the first thing that we have to be able to understand is just accept that life is not fair, okay? If you are going to try to make this life fair or think this life ought to be fair, you are never going to have inner peace. The second lesson that we looked at is you need to learn to be content with what you have. We brought nothing into this world, and we're not going to take anything out. So be content not only with what we have, but really our situation in life. We have to learn to be content with that as well. And Brian did a good job last week of talking about how we need to set ourselves free by forgiving other people. And so when we forgive other people, a lot of times that will help the inner conflict that is in our life and allow us to have this inner peace, even though the world is so chaotic around us. The point that we're going to talk about today is our fourth in our seven principles, and that is seek from forgiveness from God and others. Now, I have to be honest with you. I wrote three sermons this week. And I just didn't like the first two, so I threw them away and started over. And that doesn't happen very often. But you get to Friday morning, you're like, man, I just don't like what I have down here. I have to start over from scratch. And so I hope this lesson will be helpful to you as we look at three different important points. The first point we're going to look at is we're going to look at challenges to seeking forgiveness from God and others. So what are our barriers? Why don't we seek forgiveness from others? The second point we're going to notice, and one that probably we all struggle with at times, is the challenges that we face in accepting forgiveness from God and others. Because sometimes that's as big of a challenge as asking and seeking for the forgiveness, is just accepting that forgiveness when God offers it to us or when someone else offers it to us. And the third point we're going to consider, which is also something that I know I struggle with, and I assume that there's somebody else out in the audience this morning struggles with this, and that's just learning to forgive yourself. All right, so that's a hard thing to do as well. So when we look at the challenges that we face in all three of those areas, seeking forgiveness, accepting forgiveness, and then forgiving ourselves, and then in each of those areas, look at some practical ways we can overcome those challenges, I think that will be helpful to us. What happened is
the practical side kept growing and growing and growing and growing, so I had to get rid of all the background information I was going to give to get to this point. So we're just really sharing what would have been point number three, or just the practical side, and hopefully that will be beneficial to us as we study God's Word together today. I'm so grateful that you're all here. I'm so grateful that we have a chance to get together with God's people, people that we are at peace with, and learn from His Word together, and grow together, and be the kind of people that God wants us to be as we are traveling this life together. And hopefully we get to spend eternity together as well in heaven. That's our goal. Visiting with us, we're glad that you are here. We worship God, we study His Word, we love one another, and we reach out to the lost, all so that God can be glorified and honored in our life. And we would like for you to join us as well as we fight, as we go through this life together. Let's look at point number one. Challenges to seeking forgiveness from God and others. The first challenge that we come up with sometimes is we think that we can hide our sins from God and others. David tried that, right? He is the poster child for someone who thought, you know what? I don't want to accept this sin. I don't want anybody to find out about this sin. Maybe I can just hide it from God and others. And he tried to cover up his sin over and over and over again, and he realized he could not do this. Let's read Psalm 32, verses 1 through 5. Psalm 32 and Psalm 51 are both psalms that David wrote to show this emotional roller coaster that he was going through, this peace that he did not have internally because he was trying to hide his sin from God and what he did to finally have that inner peace. Psalm 32, verse 1 says this: "Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. When I kept silent, my bones grew old through my groaning all the day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My vitality was turned into the drought of summer. I acknowledged my sin to you. In my iniquity I have not hidden. I said, I shall confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you will forgive the iniquity of my sin." A man is not blessed. A man does not have inner peace when he covers up his sin. A man has inner peace when God covers his sin, when God blots the sin out. So if you think you're going to have inner peace because you're hiding your sin from God, or you're hiding your sin from other people, you will not. Now, Psalm 139, we're going to read verses 7 through 12. Here's an assignment I'm giving you. Read this entire psalm this week. This will be very helpful to you. So write a note in your outline. Read this entire psalm. That will be beneficial to you. We're going to read verses 7 through 12 of Psalm 139. David again says this: "Where can I go from your spirit, or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend into heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, you are there." Verse 9: "If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall fall on me, even the night shall be light about me. Indeed, the darkness shall not hide from you, but the night shines as the day. The darkness and the light are both alike to you." David finally realized that God was everywhere and God knows everything. He could not hide his sins from God, and it wasn't until he came to that realization that he could truly have that inner peace that God wanted him to have. And we know this, right? We just think it's silly to think you can hide your sins from God. But how many people throughout history have tried to do it? It started in the garden. You know, Adam and Eve thought they could hide from God behind a tree. Yeah, how silly that is. Have you seen the T-Mobile commercial where they're playing hide and seek in the desert? And so the girl turns her head, she counts, and she turns around. And right there in the desert, everybody is hiding in plain sight. And she has this puzzled look on her face like this. How do you think God looks at this world, or looks at you, or looks at me when we try to hide our sins from him? And he looks down to this earth and says, "Are you kidding me? Behind a tree? You thought you could do that?" Or what about Achan, who thought he could hide the things that he took from Jericho by digging a hole and putting them in the ground as if God can't see through dirt? God knew where that was. He saw him hide those things. He knew exactly what was taking place. Or what about Jonah? If I go get on a boat and run from God, surely God won't be able to track me down there. And then maybe they just throw me in the sea. I'll be... No! He could not hide from God. We cannot hide our sins from God. So here is our first practical application of the morning. If you have sin in your life and you think you're hiding that sin from God, whatever it is, what you need to do is acknowledge that sin and ask God to forgive you of that sin. Just stop hiding it. It's just visualize hide and seek in the desert. And that's what you're doing with God if you do that. So the second way that we sometimes find it hard to ask people for forgiveness, God and others, is that we think that our sins are unforgivable, right? We think our sins are so bad that there's no way God is going to forgive our sins. And this really was the beginning of one entire sermon that I threw away this week, but I want to bring these verses to your attention because I think this is an important part of this. Psalm 86 and verse 5 says this, "For you, Lord, are good and ready to forgive, and abundant in mercy to all those who call upon you." And if you look in the outline, I have these words underlined in Psalm 103. Look at this, how it describes God. Merciful and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in mercy. In verse 11, it says, "So great is his mercy toward us who fear him." And in verse 12, it talks about, "As far as the east is from the west, so far he has removed our transgression from us." And in the New Testament, in Colossians 1 and verse 13, or in verse 14, it talks about how we have redemption through his blood, and we have the forgiveness of our sins. So here are some things to note, first of all, from these passages. And I put these passages in parentheses after all these points, so you can go back and look at these, because some of these aren't in the outline, but I think these are important points for us to consider. First of all, our forgiveness is complete and total regardless of what our sin is, because the Lord is eager to forgive us. And the Lord is slow to our anger. Think of the prodigal son when he returned home, how eager that father was to forgive him of his sin. Our forgiveness is complete regardless of the sins that we have committed, because our forgiveness is based on God's goodness, not our goodness. Isn't that a great thought? His forgiveness is based on his goodness, not our goodness. Our forgiveness is complete no matter what sins we have committed, because God forgives us for his name's sake. Now, that was a trail that I could have traveled down for quite a while, and I wanted to, but I put three verses there for you to look up on your own that shows us what God does for his name's sake. So think about this for a second when we get into one of our other points. If God forgives you, because he loves us, of course, but also for his name's sake, and then we turn around and don't forgive ourselves for that, that's pretty bad, right? Because then we're robbing God of the glory that he wants when we are forgiven of our sins. Here's just a couple small suggestions that you can do to understand the importance of this. Find one of these verses or some other verse that to you just stands out as a verse that shows that God is merciful and compassionate and willing to forgive, and put that verse on your wall somewhere, or make it your screensaver on your phone. There's Etsy. I don't know if you guys ever do anything on Etsy. As a matter of fact, the coloring page that is in the bulletin today, adult coloring. I haven't gotten into adult coloring. Some of you may be doing this. A lot of people say it takes care of their stress. And so I put that there. You can color that outline there. But maybe do that. Color something, a verse that just really illustrates to you that God forgives sins and He's willing to forgive and eager to forgive, and post that on the screen. And then, when you do ask God to forgive, don't only ask Him to forgive your sins for your sake. Think bigger than that. Ask God to forgive your sins for His sake. That is repeated over and over and over in the Scripture. So the first point is that we have challenges in asking or seeking forgiveness. Our second point that we need to consider this morning, what are the challenges in accepting the forgiveness that God and others have already offered us? And the first challenge that I put down here is that we just keep sinning. And isn't it hard to accept forgiveness if you just keep doing the same thing over and over and over again? I think it is. I think it's hard for me to accept God's forgiveness, even though I know He wants it to do it, when I haven't overcome that sin. And that is the devil's first way of keeping you lost. Just think about this for a second. If the devil can keep you committing the same sin over and over and over again and just put it on autopilot, his job's easy, right? His job is easy. And sometimes it's hard to accept that forgiveness. So let's read a couple verses and then deal with some practical things. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, 12 through 13. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 12 through 13 says this. Therefore, let him who thinks he stand take heed lest he fall. No temptation has overtaken you except that which is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will also make the way of escape, that you may be able to bear it. So the first sense of practical application is this. Always look for the way of escape that God provides. Look for it. And that might be the scripture that you need to post somewhere in your car or on your wall or in your bathroom or where you wash dishes or whatever it is. Say, God always provides the way of escape. Look for it. Always look for it. The second idea that we need to consider from this passage is ask for help for someone who has already overcome that sin. And you go back to verse 13. It says, no temptation has overtaken you except which is common to man. And so what does that mean? Chances are, if you're struggling with a sin that you cannot overcome, there's probably someone in this building who has struggled with the same sin and has found a way to overcome that sin. And if there's not someone in this building, we know people who have struggled with whatever sin that you're struggling with, and they've overcome that, and they can help you overcome that sin as well. A very practical thing is talk to people who have already overcome. Now, don't talk to someone who hasn't overcome that sin yet, all right? Sometimes we get a tendency of doing that, you know. You have this problem, I have this problem, let's get together and solve this problem together, and that just leads to more problems usually. Talk to somebody who, through God's help and by God's grace, has overcome that, and have them help you overcome that. Here's some more practical advice from Jesus Himself in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 5. We can't have inner peace because we can't stop sinning. Well, here's what Jesus says, Matthew 5 and verse 29. If your right eye causes you to sin, pluck it out and cast it from you. For it is more profitable for you that one of your members perish than for your whole body to be cast into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and cast it from you. For it is more profitable for you that one of your members perish than for your whole body to be cast into hell. Now, Jesus isn't wanting us to mutilate ourselves. He's making this point that's how important it is that you do overcome sin. With God's help, of course, but you have a responsibility too. And our responsibility is to put as many barriers as we can between ourselves and sin. Make it hard on yourself to keep sinning. Right? Make it hard on yourself. You remember that some of you may have seen that movie called Fireproof, where a man is trying to fireproof his own wedding, his own marriage, and it's Kirk Cameron's character who's having a problem with the internet. And so what he does is he goes out and puts that computer right there in the driveway. I think he takes a sledgehammer or a baseball bat and just destroys it. Because he knows that that is what's causing me to continue to sin. So he says, I got to get rid of that. Because that's what's causing me to continue to fall back in that same sin. Would you be willing to give up your smartphone for a dumb phone if your smartphone was causing you to sin? You can't have true inner peace if you're not willing to put up those barriers between yourself and sin. And have other people hold you accountable to do that as well. I know a guy who, when he became a Christian, he linked drinking with beer. Because every time he had drinking with beer, that's a good link, drinking with pizza, okay? Because every time he ate pizza, he had a beer. So what did he do? He stopped eating pizza. Because that was something that caused him to want to go back and commit a sin that he no longer wanted to commit. We probably have all known people, and there are people in this room, I'm sure, who've had to get rid of friends because those friends encouraged you to sin. And you tell you what, Jesus speaks in terms of casting out, cutting off your arm, or plucking out your eyes. If there are friends that are keeping you from God or making you repeat your sin over and over and over again, don't fool yourself in thinking you can do that on your own. You can somehow you're going to be able to convert all of them right away when you first become a Christian, because you're not going to be able to. Sometimes you're going to have to isolate yourself from the people who are encouraging you to sin if you want to stop that sin. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 25 through 32, very important. Therefore, put away lying. Let each of you speak truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath, nor give place to the devil. Let him who stole steal no longer, but rather let him labor, working with his hands what is good, that he may have something to give to those who are in need. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification, that he may impart grace to the hearers. And let's just go down to our answers here, blank. Here's what we need to do. Replace sin with something spiritual. Okay, you having a hard time giving up the sin? Well, replace that sin. Sometimes you can't just give it. Replace it with something good. And there's a lot of examples in this text alone. Replace lying with telling the truth. Replace the temptation to be angry with someone with having a meaningful conversation that will resolve that conflict. Replace the sin of stealing with the gift of giving. And so once you realize this is a sin I keep committing over and over and over again, stop doing it, but then replace it with something else, something good, something beneficial. So instead of stealing something, replace it with working hard and giving something. That's what God wants us to do. Well, not only do we sometimes keep sinning, sometimes we stop sinning, but we keep wanting to sin. Did ever fall in that category? You keep wanting to do it? Well, a couple things here. One is you have to draw the distinction between the desire and the sin, because the desire is not always wrong. James talks about this, right? The desire, when we allow the desire to entice us, that's when the sin begins, and that's what leads to death. Matthew chapter 5, verse 27. This is what precedes when Jesus says, if your eyes cause you to sin, pluck them out. He says, you have heard that it was said of those of old, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you, whoever looks on a woman to lust for her already committed adultery with her in his heart. So how do we have inner peace even though we have a desire? We've stopped the action, but we have a desire to do that, whatever that sin may be. First, be patient with yourself, because God is. Sometimes I know that we beat ourselves up over and over and over again, and we see people beating themselves up, and they don't have this inner peace because they have this desire, and they can't get rid of this desire First, just be patient with yourself. But here are some other practical things that you can do. Remember the cost of that was paid for that sin. I'll never forget this. I was a teenager when this happened. I was at Wrigley Field, and I was sitting in the upper deck, and this drunk guy stumbled down all these stairs, and he was just as drunk as you can get. You know what I did? I laughed. And then it wasn't the next sermon. I mean, this is just the next sermon. A visiting preacher was in town. He goes, if you laugh at sin, you are laughing at what put Jesus on the cross. And it just hit me like a ton of bricks. I was laughing because I failed to see the cost Jesus paid for that sin. And if I can see the cost that Jesus paid because of my sin, I'm going to become less and less desirous to do that sin. Another way that I can stop having a desire to do sin is to look at the consequence of that sin, not just the pleasure of that sin. Hebrews chapter 12, it's just in verse 17. You can read that on your own. But Esau, it says, he found no place for repentance, although he sought it diligently with tears. He suffered a consequence for the sin. And we can keep that in mind. Hey, I'm going to think a lot less about committing that sin if I can just, instead of looking at the enjoyment of that sin, look at the consequence of that sin. And if we can teach ourselves to do that and our children to do that, we will have accomplished something great. Another thing that we need to do is we need to see that sin the way God sees that sin. And Peter puts it in a very descriptive way. It's like a dog returning to vomit. And if I can see the sin that I want to commit over and over and over again, I can just see myself returning to vomit. Maybe that'll stop me having that desire to commit that sin. Or a pig wallowing in the mud. But ultimately, we're going to overcome that bad desire or replacing it with good desires. Philippians chapter 4. Philippians chapter 4, a passage that probably would be one of those good passages to put up on our wall or put as our screensaver, right? A passage that we should all try to memorize. Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. Finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue and if anything worthy of praise, meditate on these things. The things which you have learned and received and heard and saw in me, these do, and the God of peace will be with you. Fill your mind with good thoughts if you're having bad thoughts. Get those bad thoughts out of your head by replacing it with God's Word. Meditate on God's Word on a regular basis. Sometimes things aren't as complicated as we make them. You talk about sports, just getting back to blocking and tackling, right? In Christianity, sometimes the best way to get rid of evil desires is just spend more time in God's Word, studying God's Word, praying to God. Replace a sinful desire with a good desire. And goes back to let him who stole steal no longer, but let him work and give. And you'll find so much, the Lord says, it's more blessed to give than to receive. You'll find so much more pleasure in the giving than the taking that you'll want to give instead of wanting to take. Isn't it amazing that God does that for us? He creates us in a ways that he knows how we work. And then he tells us in his word, this will work for you if you just listen to me. Our third point is this challenge to forgive ourselves. The first challenge in forgiving ourselves is that we like or we have a hard time not dwelling on our past failures. And this is a tool of the devil. Because if he can't get you to commit the same sin, and if he can't get you to want to commit those sins any longer, he's just going to keep you thinking about, remember how bad you used to be? Remember how bad you used to be? Remember how all those sins that you used to commit, yeah, I don't commit that sin anymore. I don't desire to commit that sin anymore. Oh, yeah, but you're so bad. You did. And that's what the devil tries to get us to do. Here's what God wants. God wants you to remember your past sins. But he wants you to remember your past failures so that you can truly be in awe of his grace and forgiveness. Right? Because if I'm aware of my past sin and I'm aware that God forgave me of that sin, then for his name's sake, he could be honored and glorified for forgiving me of those sins. And God wants us to remember our past failures to prevent us from repeating that, robbing us of our future happiness and our current happiness. That's why God wants us to remember our past sins. But I'll tell you what, the devil wants us to remember our past failures so he can rob us of this inner peace. And he can rob us of our future glory that God wants to give us. Because if we keep dwelling on our past sins, we will be useless for God. Philippians chapter 3 and verse 12. Paul knew this, and in the articles, it's tracking Paul's life, right? And we noted last time that we could track David's life through all these seven principles as well. Paul says this in Philippians chapter 3 and verse 12, "Not that I have already attained or am already perfected, but I press on that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus." This is going to sound like that's not very practical, but sometimes the only practical advice you can give is the straightforward stuff. Forget the past and remember what your goal is. How devastating could Paul have made his life if he just kept remembering all the people he tortured? He remembered them to remember God forgave him for him, right? God could be honored for that sin, that overcoming that sin in his life. He remembered them so he wouldn't repeat them. But he had to forget them or he would have been paralyzed. I want you to read. I have the whole verse there, Colossians 1 or 3, 1 through 17. We're not going to read it all. I'm going to read the first few verses to you. I want you to read the whole context later, though. It says, "If you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above where Christ is, sitting at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on things of the earth. For you died and your life is hidden with Christ in God." You want to know how to have that inner peace in the outer chaos? Even though you have sinned and messed up your life, set your mind where God is. Put your mind in heaven, where he is. Don't think about your past sins, but think about your future glory. Think about where God is taking you, not where he has necessarily taken you from. If you read the whole text, you'll see that there is a sense in which you remember your old sins and that was who you were, but remember them for the right reasons, not the devil's reasons. Surround yourself with forgiving people who are not interested in the sinner that you used to be, but in the saint you've become and who God will make you in the future. And then let the peace of God rule in your heart because of that. You are forgiven. If you've been washed in the blood of Jesus Christ, regardless of how much Satan wants to tell you you're bad and evil and you're not worth the forgiveness, God forgave you. Forgive yourself for those sins. And I know for us, I'll just be honest with you, for us, for those of us who have grown up in cultures sometimes where people have beaten other people up with their past sins and have beaten us up with our past sins, and we've been tempted to beat other people up for their past sins, this is hard. It's hard to forgive ourselves and move on from our past sins. But you know what? When you finally overcome these sins and you don't have you're not committing the sin, you don't have the desire to commit the sin, and you've put those sin, past sins out of your mind, you know what the devil's going to do next? He's going to bring people to remind you of those past sins. Now, he's not going to give this thing up. He's not. This is the outer chaos. That's what he's good at, right? He wants to stir up as much outer chaos and internal chaos as he can. So what we need to do sometimes is we're going to have to cut ties with people who constantly remind us of how bad we used to be and find people who totally will forgive us of our past sins. And this is really something that I misworded here in this next phrase here. We need to continue to develop and maintain an atmosphere of forgiveness here at PSD. That's important, right? So we need to develop. I think we need to continue to develop and maintain this atmosphere that we already have. And then there's another reason why we can't forgive ourselves is because although, as Brian pointed out in that article, most people are willing to forgive us, some people won't, and that drives us nuts, right? When other people won't forgive us, it just makes us want to latch onto that sin as well. But the reality is, sometimes people won't forgive us of our sins, and we're going to have to live with that reality too. Joab never forgave Abner for killing his brother. Absalom never forgave Amnon for sinning against his sister. And you might say, those were unrepented of sins. Maybe. I mean, you have Abner didn't want to kill Joab's brother. He tried to give Joab's brother as many outs as he could. And then there was some peace that was sort of made there, and Joab's, all right, I'm going to leave you alone for a while. But he just couldn't let it go. There will be people in your life that will not let your sin go. They will try to hold that against you. Paul knew that. In 1 Corinthians chapter 4, starting in verse 1, he talks about how our sin is something that we need to be able to let go of because God lets go of it. Let a man so consider us as servants of Christ and stewards of the ministries of God. Moreover, if it is required in stewards that one be found faithful, but with me it is a very small thing that I should be judged by you or by a human court. In fact, I do not even judge myself. For I know nothing against myself, yet I am not justified by this, but he who judges me is the Lord. Therefore, judge nothing before the time until the Lord comes, who will bring both to light the hidden things of the dark and the darkness and reveal the counsel of the heart. Then each man's praise will come from God. Accept the reality that some people are not going to forgive you. They never will forgive you. But that has absolutely no bearing on your salvation. If you've sought that forgiveness and you've repented of that sin and you've tried to make it where that person could forgive you, if they don't forgive you, that will not keep you out of heaven. There's nothing else you can do. We all do things that we shouldn't and that we're ashamed of. And then there's this last one that I think we do sometimes. Somehow we think if we can beat ourselves up enough, then maybe that's how we get forgiveness. And we realize that sin requires a consequence. And so what do? We try to impose a consequence that's not a natural consequence of ourselves. You get this idea, we just feel like we just got to keep flogging ourselves for the sins that we've committed in the past. And somehow, if we flog ourselves enough for our past sins, this will be enough punishment for our sins. And God will accept that. We'll accept the punishment we inflict on ourselves. That seems like, oh yeah, that's self-righteous, but it's not righteousness. It is self-righteousness. That's what it is. And it does not give God the glory for him forgiving our sins through Jesus. So I just want to read one more verse, Ephesians chapter 2, starting in verse 4. But God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved and raised us up together and made us to sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace we have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any one of us should boast. Here's our practical statement here. Stop trying to earn your way to heaven or punish your way to heaven. Accept God's grace for His name's sake. And we need to constantly remind one another of that. God's forgiven you. If you've been washed in the blood of Jesus Christ, He's forgiven you of all of your past sins. Quit beating yourself up over that sin. It's sort of insulting to God when we do that, isn't it? Jesus paid the price for that sin. You don't have to. So quit beating yourself up over those past sins and accept the forgiveness from God and from others. And that is so hard for us to do. If you are separated from God because of your sin, you will not have inner peace. And you know what? I hate to tell you this. Maybe I don't hate to tell you this. And I'm going to encourage all of us to do this. Pray that God won't allow you to have inner peace. If you're in sin right now and you know you're in sin, and you think you're going to have inner peace just by looking over your sin, hiding your sin, ignoring your sin, not dealing with your sin, or dealing with your sin yourself, I hope you don't have inner peace. Because you'll never do anything about it. But if you're here today and you have sins that you have not allowed God to forgive, there's no reason why you should carry that sin with you another day. If you're willing to accept God's grace, if you're willing to accept His grace on His terms, and to confess your sin like David did, I acknowledged my sin. And after I acknowledged my sin and let God forgive me of that sin, that was when He lifted His heavy hand off of me and made me have true inner peace. If you want to do that today, you can. You can confess that you believe Jesus Christ is the Son of God. You can repent of those sins, turn your back. You know, you're still going to be tempted by that. You're not going to overcome them in one day, right? You're not going to overcome them in 1 week or 1 month or even necessarily in 1 year. Keep making strides and let Him help you. But if you're willing to be immersed in water, every single sin, and it's not the water, it's the blood of Jesus that does it, right? It is the blood of Jesus. We come in contact with the blood of Jesus. He's paid for it. You could leave this building today totally sin-free. Amen. We want that for you. Amen. And then what we want to do is we want to help you forget about your old sins, forget about your past life, and live a new life in Jesus and get the glory that He has reserved for you and be in heaven. And if you're a Christian, and if you have found out, I've already been washed in the blood of Jesus, but I just can't forgive myself, or I just can't accept this grace. I keep trying to punish my way into heaven or work my way into heaven. And if you need prayers and help from us, we'll be glad to give those to you. If we can help you have true inner peace by having true peace with God, because of the Prince of Peace and being washed in His blood, we can help you in any way. We ask you to come as we stand and sing.